At one time, I was spending a lot more time on the internet, and I ran across a man that he was pretty well educated about Buddhism, but he kept on saying, you know, it's too bad that the Buddha only taught one meditation in all of his suttas. And I said, well, that's not even close to being right. And he said, no, he doesn't talk anything about how to live your life with a meditation with the bend towards meditation. So I pulled this sutta out and I sent it to him. And this is how to live your life with your daily activities. And this is called the simile of the saw.
Which number?
Hmm?
21.
21.
Monks, there are these five courses of speech that others may use when they address you. Their speech may be timely or untimely, true or untrue, gentle or harsh, connected with good or with harm, spoken with a mind of loving kindness or with inner hate. When others address you, their speech may be timely or untimely. When others address you, their speech may be true or untrue. When others address you, their speech may be gentle or harsh. When others address you, their speech may be connected with good or with harm. When others address you, their speech may be spoken with a mind of loving kindness or with inner hate. Herein you should train thus. Our minds will be unaffected, and we shall utter no evil words. We shall abide compassionate for their welfare, with a mind of loving kindness, without inner hate. We shall abide pervading that person with a mind imbued with loving kindness. And starting with him, we shall abide pervading the all-encompassing world with a mind imbued with loving kindness. Abundant, exalted, immeasurable, without hostility and without ill will. That is how you should train. Now, if that's not a daily practice, I don't know what is. But the thing that is real important that for you to train yourself so that you don't get upset by other people's words is to, whenever somebody comes and they start talking to you, radiate loving kindness to that person while they're talking. Radiate that loving kindness. And then when they go away and you start walking around, radiate loving kindness to all beings around you. Okay, so you use that person that you're talking to as a reminder to keep your loving kindness going all the time. It's real amazing sometimes to see some people that are not real happy with each other. Complete strangers. You don't even know what they're talking about. It doesn't matter. But when you use them as your reminder to start radiating loving kindness, they will stop being harsh with each other. They will start to settle down. And they'll start to discuss, and then after a little while, you'll see them start to laugh with each other. Now, when you see them laugh, okay, you've done your job, you can walk away. But this is a reminder to keep your mind focused on loving kindness as much as you can remember, and don't take what other people say too seriously. Even if they come at you with their anger or dissatisfaction, whatever it happens to be, you can still radiate loving kindness to them. We have this, we put it up all over the meditation hall, the dining hall, the kitchen, all kinds of places as a reminder to be careful with your speech and be compassionate and send loving and kind thoughts to whoever you're talking to. Now, one of the things that a lot of people ask me about at the end of a retreat is, how much should I meditate when I get home? You should never ask me those questions. See, I have one student that he sits 3 hours in the morning. He goes, does his daily stuff, work or whatever. When he comes home, he sits 4 hours at home. 4 hours in the evening. So he sits 7 hours a day. That's a good Well, it is. That's a good amount. I know that you're not going to do it. I really recommend that you sit at least 1 hour a day. When you get off retreat, you're not going to be go as deep in your meditation as you are right now. That's just, you're going to be more active, you're going to be moving around. That's just the way it is. I highly recommend that you sit an hour in the morning. The reason I say to sit an hour in the morning, it's a nice way to start the day. But don't just get up out of bed and try to sit. Do your morning things. Wash, do, eat, whatever. And then sit. If you wait until the evening to do your meditation, what happens is somebody comes by, one of your friends, and says, let's go to the movie. Okay, I can meditate tomorrow. And then tomorrow comes and something else happens, and before long you're not sitting at all. So if you get in the habit of sitting in the morning, and then in the evening, if you have some time and you want to sit, you call that your bonus time. But quite often in the evening, because you've been working all day, you've been very active, you have a tendency to get real sleepy and tired, so you don't want to sit as long, and you wind up sitting for only a half an hour or something like that. So if you sit in the morning, it's a nice way to start the day. And then any other meditation you do during the day is your bonus time. That's really good. I have had students that they would get up at between 3 and 4 o'clock every morning and sit for 2 hours before their kids got up. And then their active day with the kids, you all understand what that's like. So his progress was quite good. when he was doing that. It's real amazing what happens when you get off retreat. You go home, and the first day or two, you still have pretty good meditation, and then after that, it's not as good. You're not going to be able to go as deep. So what you do is go back to the loving kindness in the six directions. And eventually your mind will get to the compassion and the joy and the equanimity. But it'll take a while to build it back up. And that's fine. Now, the thing with loving kindness is you're in charge of yourself. If you want to sit and just be in the first jhana for an hour or 2 hours, then make a determination. And the determination that you make is, I'm not going to go any higher than the first jhana for this sitting. Okay. Now, with that kind of determination, you're going to stay in the first jhana. What's the advantage of being in the first jhana? You get to learn a lot about it. There's a lot of subtle little things that you don't really notice. But when you get in the habit of sitting like that, say you do that for a week. Okay, you're going to understand the first jhana pretty well. And you're going to be able to get into the first jhana very quickly. And there's a lot of advantages to doing that, especially when you get into a stressful kind of situation. So you can start radiating loving kindness to people around you. Or you can go into the second jhana. It's your choice. You can just start radiating to different people when you're walking down the street. It's up to you what you're doing with your mind. Understand that you are in charge of what happens around you. In other words, you want to affect people around you in a positive way? Start radiating loving kindness to individuals or to people around you. It doesn't matter. And stay with it as long as you want. Men, it's not a good idea to look women in the eye when you're radiating loving kindness. Women, it's not a good idea to radiate loving kindness to men when you're radiating love, sending love to them. Don't look them in the eye. That is misunderstood, and it can cause all kinds of problems. And infatuations and all the things that you don't necessarily want to have happen. It's up to you. So the more you can remember to radiate loving kindness, or if you want to do forgiveness meditation because something's bothering you or somebody else and you need to forgive them, it's your choice what you do and how to do it. Now, I've tried to show you fastest way to let go of attachments, and I've tried to show you the easiest way to stay with someone when you're radiating loving kindness to them. But when you get home, it's yours. Now, if you happen to run across any kind of problems that you don't understand, you can always get in touch with David. And he gets in touch with me, and we'll come back with what we can suggest to help you. So, if you want to do an online retreat, let David know. He'll arrange to have you. We have a few people that are teaching online retreats. It's a commitment that you have to make if you sign up for it. And that's, what is it, 8 days, 9 days?
Yeah, 9 days.
9 days. Okay. And he'll give you the instructions, but basically every day you take the precepts and do the little morning service, sit for an hour, get up, go to work. Now, when you're at work, you still have to be doing some meditation, and that means smile. Oh, but I've got to work on a computer. Can't you smile while you're typing? Keep your mind light. Watch what your mind is doing. It's okay to use the 6 hours in your daily practice, right? Now, you've been watching hindrances come up. And just because you're not sitting in meditation doesn't mean that you're not going to have hindrances come up during your daily life. But now you have a tool to help overcome these kind of problems and these kinds of suffering. So, don't forget, that's why I'd like for you, everybody, to have one of these and put it on your desk and remind yourself every now and then that to use the 6 hours and to keep your precepts as closely as you can. Now, I know what life is like, and I know sometimes you get carried away and you forget and say something that's not necessarily true. Okay, when you notice that you've done that, you will feel very guilty. If there's not a monk around or another spiritual friend around, forgive yourself for making a mistake. Take the precepts again right then. And make a determination that you're not going to do that again. Okay, that'll help clear your mind. And taking the precepts again will help purify your mind. So, as you get more and more used to doing this, the temptation to break a precept becomes less and less and less. And your mindfulness becomes, your just general mindfulness becomes much sharper. You're going to notice more clearly what you're going to say before you say it, and what you're going to do before you do it. So then you can make the choice of whatever you're going to do or say. But know that when you break a precept, it is going to cause hindrances to come up and it's going to cause problems for you. So, keep your precepts as closely as you can. Any time you have repeat thoughts, you have aversion in your mind. I don't like that. means there's an attachment there. What do you do when you have repeat thoughts? When you're sitting in meditation? Six R. That's what you do in real life too. Look at how your mind attaches to certain ideas and certain things. And back off. It's not that important. Forgive that person for causing that. Or forgive yourself for doing that, whatever it happens to be. You're gonna start becoming more and more aware of how you cause your own pain. And as you keep your precepts more closely, as you keep your practice and try to keep your mind uplifted, those things will start to fade away. They just won't bother you as much. You won't have as much emotional upset. So, that's what the meditation is for, is to teach you how to handle this sort of thing and how to let it go, let go of that suffering. I was at a school for naturopathic doctors, and I gave a talk, and they said, well, what do you do with somebody that has depression? That's a pretty valid question. Everybody has depression at some point, right? Well, what is depression? What happens first? What happens after that? What happens after that? First thing you notice, painful feeling arises. I don't like that painful feeling. I don't want it around. Then you have a story that goes along with it. And then you have your habitual tendency. And what that habitual tendency is, that feeling arises, then you try to think the feeling away because you have that story that's always attached to the feeling when it's like this. And you continually get caught up in trying to think that feeling. But feelings are one thing, thoughts are something else. It doesn't work. That's the importance of using the six R's. But you can't use the six R's as some kind of a stick to beat away a feeling. It doesn't work. One of the things that I told you on the first day, you have to learn how to laugh. Why? When you laugh with yourself, it changes your perspective. When you laugh with yourself for being depressed, you're not depressed anymore. It's only this feeling. It's easy to let it go. Look at the attachment you have to that kind of feeling. How much do you identify with that feeling? This is me, this is mine. I'm sad and I don't like it and I don't want to be around it. And it, all of this pain and suffering that you caused to yourself. So, I've had quite a few students that have panic attacks. PTSD. That's a panic attack. It's a memory of something that happened in the past that's coming back, and you're reliving it. That's what depression is all about. So, what do you do with a panic attack? Huh? You don't get up and you don't run around and you don't hide and you don't get so involved in it that you're caught up with thinking about it all the time. Calm your mind. You use 6 R's. Not in a panicked way, but it'll disappear pretty quick if you don't make a big deal out of it in your mind. That's the thing that's real important. And that's something that a lot of people kind of forget when they're doing their meditation. They make big deal out of things, and then they come to me and they say, "Oh, my mind was so active." Well, what are you making a big deal out of this time? So don't make a big deal out of it. It's just a feeling. It's just thoughts. They aren't even yours. You don't ask them to come up, do you? You tell yourself, you know, please, I've been too happy lately. I gotta get depressed. And look at how you take it seriously and how you think that this feeling and this thought is yours personally. And how much do you fight with it and how much do you try to control it? This meditation is by far the most powerful meditation that I know of, because it helps you to relax into things. Don't take things so personally. Don't get involved with repeat thoughts just like they're on a tape deck. I've told you that I've had some people that they get into their panic attack pretty heavy, and they'll come and they'll start complaining to me about, "Oh, I'm just suffering so much, it hurts so bad." Okay, 6 R. "Oh, I can't 6 R, it doesn't work." Well, yeah, it does. But you haven't got the patience to use it. So, okay, laugh. It's not funny. Yeah, it is. It's really funny. Why? Because you're taking something that's not even yours and you're making it yours and you're trying to control it. That's weird. What are you doing that to yourself for? Laugh. And look at how your mind feels when you're done. So it's something that it takes a little practice to remember. See, that's the thing with mindfulness. It's remembering to observe how mind's attention moves. When you forget, then you have suffering. So, lighter your mind becomes. Give your smile away. Give your loving kindness away. Doesn't matter whether you know that person or not, give it to them. The more you practice your generosity and you're giving your smile away and you're radiating loving kindness to people and stores and whatever, in sporting events, at movies, whatever, you radiate that loving kindness and you smile and they hear you laugh every now and then. Oh, that helps them to be happy. That helps remind them. And then you be caught up in your thoughts about this or that while you're at a store and somebody walks right beside you and you look at them and they're smiling at you. Oh, thanks. That was a nice reminder. What you give, you get. That's karma, right? You give happy feelings away, what's going to come back at you? It works. The more you can remember to smile, the more you can remember to have fun. The more you affect the world around you in a positive way. So, your choice. How do you want to affect the world around you? Do you want to get involved in your harshness towards yourself? You want to get involved in your dislike of yourself because you made a mistake? Or can you forgive yourself for making a mistake and learn from the mistake so you don't do it again? That's what meditation is about. That's what the Buddhist teaching is about. It's about learning how to be happy all the time. And meditation helps you. It purifies your mind while you're sitting in the meditation. It's not a maybe. It really does work. And that's why you're starting to feel right now the changes that you're going through right now. Oh, I'm more happy than I was when I first started. Yeah? Why? Because you've let go of some craving. You've seen how this process works. And you start to have more and more confidence. And the more confidence you have in this process, the easier everything becomes. And the more fun you have. So, your choice what you do when you get off retreat. I've given you the suggestions. You can do whatever you want. But if you run into a problem, you can always get in touch with us. We'll help you. That's our job. See, I got the best job in the world. You can't get any better than that. I show you how to be happy. And then I help you to be happy. If you run across some kind of problem, I'm going to let us know and we can help you adjust so that you can re-remember how to do it. So, be happy. Smile. Laugh. Have fun. fun. Teach other people to do the same thing. Okay? Okay, do you have any questions? Wow. You mean I've taught you so well?
So yesterday you mentioned about a TV and newspaper. Nowadays the young people are not addicted to game, you know, video game. How do you help them to release that habit?
Well, the first thing, it depends on how young the people are. But if they're any younger than 5, I would not allow them to be around telephones and the games like that. One of the problems with these electronic games is you can do it by yourself. And you need, your first little bit of life, you need to be able to interact with other kids. And you need to be able to play with them and have fun with them. That doesn't have to do with staring at a screen. When I was a kid, I had 4 brothers, and we'd go out into the forest and we played tree tag. That means we'd climb up in the trees and swing like Tarzan from one tree to another and play tag and do all kinds of weird things like that. And when we got up in the morning, one of the things that my mother absolutely insisted on was that we left. And what a nice way to start a day, and a nice way to have connection with your siblings. So encouraging that kind of activity is most important, especially up until they're 5 or 6 years old. And then I would only allow them so long. You can only do this for 30 minutes, then you have to do other things. Reading books, that's getting to be a lost art. It really is. Well, I had one of my brothers, he moved up to a place that was way out. It was out in the forest, and they didn't have any television, they didn't have any radio, and they were, it must have been 35 miles to the closest town that had a movie house. So they had to learn, my brother's kids had to learn to entertain each other. And they had games, they had board games that they would play, and they had a lot of fun time together. And sometimes the older ones would read a story, they'd say, run across a story, this, hey, this is a good story, I'm gonna, and they'd start reading to their younger brothers and sisters. And they grew up to be very healthy individuals, and they were creative, and they'd run across a problem, and they learned how to solve it, because they were out in the forest, and you got a problem, it's a real one. You got to take care of it right now. You got to fix it. So, you can tell that I really like being out in the forest. not being, well, we're kind of, we have electricity, and we do have some internet, and we do have some of these kind of things. But I like being quiet. being alone. I don't sit in meditation when I give a meditation class because I like to be alone when I'm sitting. I'm used to that. And I get great meditation when I'm alone, but quite often people start depending on whatever, with if I'm radiating loving kindness, and they want this closer to Bhante. And then they start picking up weird thoughts from people. I like being alone. And I have developed the habit of getting up 2-3 o'clock and then sitting till 9-10 o'clock in the morning. Sometimes I don't. I don't have any set rigid schedule. And I don't expect you to have one either. Don't be over rigid with your practice. Keep it soft. Keep it simple. Okay? And you can radiate loving kindness any time of the day or night. It's up to you. Yeah.
But in what cases you suggest, or when you suggest to radiate compassion?
It's up to you. There was a magazine about people that were helping other people, and they wrote articles about compassion, and they were spending time with people that were dying and being with the friends, and they started talking about getting burned out because they were trying to take the pain away from other people that were suffering. And you can't do it. It doesn't work. And they could do it for about a year or 2 years, and then they have to stop. They have to go do something else. Now, I was at a hospital in Florida where I was giving a talk to these nurses that were working in the cancer area for kids. And the kids were going to die. And they got burned out. They could only do it for so long, and then they had to go to another place in the hospital and work. Because they became very close friends with the family, and they just started taking on that sadness and that pain. That doesn't have anything to do with compassion. Now, I've given you the definition of compassion already. I gave it to you. It is allowing another person to have their own pain. Allowing that space for them to have their pain and love them no matter what. I can't take your pain away. Have you ever walked into a room where somebody's depressed and you feel like turning around and walking out? You know what I'm talking about. I can go into a room like that without any problem at all, because I'm not going to try to take their pain away, but I'm going to have fun. I'm going to play. I'm going to laugh. I'm going to radiate loving kindness. And before long, they're not depressed anymore. And they'll think you're some kind of magic person, because you allowed them the space to be the way they were going to be, and it's okay. They can have pain, but I don't have to take it. I can't take it. If I try to take their pain, I make myself unhappy. And how is that going to help anybody else around me? Right? So what is compassion? I've spent about a year, almost every day I got invited to go to hospitals because somebody in the family was really sick. And it was always amazing to me to walk into a room and it was just down. I mean, the energy was just horrible. And I started realizing that the family members, they felt helpless. And they were trying to take the pain away and they just made themselves more and more suffering. And they made themselves more and more miserable. So they'd be there for a short period of time and say, I gotta go. Now, how family members are supposed to be there to help, but they don't know what to do. You don't ever have to be helpless. You can always help. Like I did with my mother when she was dying. I radiated equanimity, acceptance. She was very dearly loved by everybody. She was a matriarch of the family. Anybody that had any problems, they went to her and she helped solve them. Everybody really, really liked her a lot. But they weren't crying when she was dying. Because I was radiating loving kindness. I was radiating equanimity. So they had a balanced mind. Okay, you never have to be helpless. You can always help by not trying to take somebody else's pain away, but by radiating loving kindness to them, or radiate joy to them, or radiate compassion to them. Whatever you feel is appropriate at the time. Somebody that has a lot of pain, you can start radiating some joy. And that helps them have balance. You can radiate equanimity. That helps them have balance. You can radiate loving kindness. That helps them have balance. You don't have to sit there and be sad because mom's dying. You can be happy. And you can... One of the things that I found was real helpful with people that they were getting close to death is talk to them about the things they liked when they were growing up. What was your family like? How much fun did you have with your family? What did you do with them? You remember a time when you did something that really made them happy? You use that kind of speech that they're not focusing on the pain anymore. And that's starting to let some of the endorphins into their body so the pain becomes less and less. And their mind becomes more and more clear. So, your choice. What are you going to do? What are you going to do with somebody that is in extreme pain and they're afraid? They don't want to die. They're afraid of death. Well, what's to be afraid of? Really? You don't have to talk to them about death, but talk to them about life. Make sense? Teach the family members to send loving and kind thoughts. Teach them how to be helpful. to the person that's sick and everybody else in the family. Quite often I go to school where there's kids that are between 6 and 9 years old, right around that age. And they're kind of at a pretty active, anxious time. And I tell them that when they go to bed at night, if they want to have sweet dreams, then before they go to sleep, they get mom or dad to sit beside them and out loud start wishing mom happiness, wish dad happiness, wish brother happiness, and hold that happy feeling every night. You do it for your friends, you do it for your teachers, you do it for everybody in your family. You get them to do that every night. They will not have these scary dreams that wake them up, and then they wake up crying. It won't happen. Their dreams start to be really nice, and that starts to change the way they look at other people around them. Especially when you start saying, oh, don't you have a friend that you want to send some loving thought to? Yeah, okay, let's do that. But you got to do it every night with your child, or children as the case may be. And that's going to affect the world around them in a very positive way. And they're going to start to be more creative. They're going to start to be more alert. They're not going to have so much problem with greed and dislike and all of these kind of little kid things that we all have still in us. Well, that comes from not learning it when we were really young. Okay? So you have kids? Great. Teach them how to do loving kindness. One of my students is a naturopathic doctor. And he's a heck of a meditator. He's really good. And he got in the habit when his son was 2 and 3 years old. He would sit down and do meditation, and his son would come up and sit on his lap. So he would teach his son, feel that warm feeling here. Hold that warm feeling. Wish mom some happy. He's 7 years old now. He's a brilliant kid. And balanced. It takes doing it every day. You want to train yourself to be happy? It's easy. Do it every day. And wish somebody that you don't know happiness. Wish all beings happiness. Do it as much as you can remember. Okay? Anything else? Tomorrow morning, you take 5 pieces. Then you can eat any time you want. last chance? Going once? Twice? Okay. Cheers.
Of all kinds of happiness.